The final class of syllogisms that we're going to consider are disjunctive syllogisms. Remember that a disjunctive syllogism is going to be a syllogism containing a disjunctive proposition. Now, there's one thing that all disjunctive syllogisms share in common. The first premise of every disjunctive syllogism will always be the disjunctive proposition. The P or Q gets listed first. Now, where things get interesting with disjunctive syllogisms is with the second premise. So the first possibility that we want to consider is that the second premise denies one of the disjuncts. In the argument on the left, it's the first disjunct that's denied, whereas in the argument on the right, it's the second disjunct. It should be clear that something validly follows from the combination of each of these premises. In the left-hand argument, it's Q that follows, whereas in the right-hand argument, it's P that follows. Where things get a little tricky is with the second possibility. This is where the second premise affirms one of the disjuncts. So again, in the argument on the left, it's P that's affirmed, whereas in the argument on the right, it's Q that's affirmed. Whether something validly follows from each of these depends on whether the disjunctive proposition is inclusive or exclusive. Let's begin then with possibility 2A. Here, the second premise affirms one of the disjuncts, and the disjunctive proposition is inclusive. Remember that to say that a disjunctive proposition is inclusive is to say that it asserts P or Q is the case, and maybe both. In the argument on the left, we have P or Q, inclusive, and P. Whereas in the argument on the right, we have P or Q is the case, and Q. So what follows from each of these? In fact, nothing does. Let's focus on the argument on the left. Premise 1 is saying P or Q is the case, and maybe both. Well, what follows if P is true? We don't know. Q could be true, Q could be false. So these don't combine to give us anything. Another possibility is that the second premise affirms one of the disjuncts, and the disjunctive proposition is exclusive. So to say that a disjunctive proposition is exclusive is to say that it asserts that either P or Q is true, but they can't both be true. If we encounter an argument like this, remember that we're going to underline the word or to represent that it's exclusive. So here we have two arguments with an exclusive disjunctive proposition as the first premise. In the argument on the left, the second premise asserts P. Well, if it's true that P and P and Q can't both be true, then it follows that not Q. Similarly, in the argument on the right, P or Q is asserted as being true in the first premise, but they can't both be true. The second premise tells us that Q is true, so it follows then that not P. Summing up then, we have four valid disjunctive syllogisms. Any other combination of premises and conclusions with these will be invalid. The validity of disjunctive syllogisms is really quite straightforward. The only time they become tricky is when their second premise affirms one of the disjuncts. That's when you need to be attentive to whether the disjunctive proposition is inclusive or exclusive. So long as you're careful about that, you should have no problems at all.